In this section, we're going to cover sales contracts, and we're going to talk about the differences in our general common law of contracts that we covered in the last section and the contracts governing sales and leases of goods that are governed under the UCC. So goods are generally defined as movable, tangible pieces of property. This would be your desk, your computer, your books, your clothes, your car. It would not be a house or land or anything permanently affixed to it. It would also not be services. Future goods are goods not yet in existence or under control of people. So if I make a contract for the purchase of crops that they haven't grown yet, or young animals, I buy a puppy dog from a breeder and the dog isn't born yet. That's a future good. The lease of goods is also going to be covered under the UCC. There are hybrid contracts, and these include both goods and services. And these, it's important to determine which prevails, which is more predominant, by determining the ultimate goal of the parties when the contract was formed. This is important because goods are governed under the UCC, but services are not. And remember, as a review, the UCC stands for the Uniform Commercial Code, and portions of it have been adopted in all 50 states to make transacting business across state lines fairly straightforward and similar between states. For sales contracts, the UCC is going to impose a duty of good faith obligation on the parties. They must transact with each other in good faith. Also, usage of trade or common methods of dealing in a particular field are going to be respected under the UCC. They're going to be used to supplement the terms of the contract, as well as past dealings. If we have done business over and over and we've done it in this manner, then courts would interpret the contract as they had historically and as we had interpreted the contract historically. For a sales contract under the UCC, for the formation, we have to have an offer and acceptance, but the acceptance may be made in any reasonable manner. A contract for the purchase of goods can be accepted by a shipment of those goods. If I made a contract and I'm shipped conforming goods, that means the goods conform with the contract. They're exactly what we contracted for. If we make a contract for the sale of goods and I ship non-conforming goods, those are not the same as those in the contract, and I may be able to accept the contract by accepting them or reject the contract by sending them back. A firm offer is one that holds the offer open for a specified period of time. We've talked about this before under the common law, and generally a firm offer required consideration. However, under the UCC, there's no consideration requirement when a merchant promises in writing to hold the offer open for the sale or lease of goods. And a merchant is in the business of buying and selling the type of goods that are the subject of the contract. The writing must be signed and specify a time that the offer will remain open, not exceeding 3 months. The UCC also allows open price terms, whereas that would not be allowed under the common law. The contract can be legal so long as the price is reasonable at the time the goods are delivered. The UCC allows output and requirements contracts. An output contract is an agreement to sell all the things manufactured or produced to a buyer allowed, and it's allowed so long as it's in good faith and it's reasonable. A buyer can also have a requirements contract where they agree to buy all the goods and supplies they need from a business. So I agree to buy all my raw materials from you. This is allowed so long as it's in good faith and reasonable. An additional term in the acceptance is also allowed under the UCC. So if we have a contract, a buyer and seller have a contract, and the buyer accepts the contract but also adds a few terms, under our old common law, that would be a counteroffer. That would not be an acceptance of the contract. Under the UCC, it can be an acceptance of the contract. The additional terms are treated as proposals for addition to the contract if the parties are non-merchants, and they're treated as part of the contract unless they're objected to by merchants, or there's a material change to the contract, or there's language prohibiting this in the contract. And modifications of the contract don't need additional consideration under the UCC like they did in the common law. Under the UCC, the statute of frauds is going to require the contract to be in writing if it's a sale of goods valued at over $500 or if it's a lease of goods and the total payments required over the whole lease are over $1,000. So that means a 12-month lease and each monthly rent is $100. That's $1,200. That's going to require a writing. Whereas under the common law, remember, our contracts did not have to be in writing. There's four exceptions to this. Oral contracts between merchants where a written confirmation is received by one party and not objected to by the other within 10 days. So merchants can orally agree if they confirm in writing. Specifically, manufactured goods don't have to be in writing, and those are goods that are manufactured for one specific purpose, and they can't be sold just out to the general public. Also, if a party makes an admission in court, they admit in court that this contract existed, they can't turn around and say they don't have to perform because it wasn't in writing. And then finally, executed contracts, those contracts where the parties have already performed, we can't then go to court and say that even though we've already performed, I don't have to pay because it wasn't in writing. A sufficient writing under the UCC mentions the agreement and includes the quantity of goods and is signed by the party against whom enforcement is sought. And a signature can be any mark made with the intent to authenticate. So it could be an X, it could be a scribble, as long as it was made with the intention to authenticate the contract. Contracts that happen online for the sale of goods are allowed. We buy things on Amazon all the time. These are contracts and they're allowed. Even if they're over $500, they're allowed because of the eSign Act. And that says as long as both parties have agreed to conduct business electronically, cyber contracts have the same legal effect as other contracts. The Uniform Electronic Transactions Act basically says the same thing, but it only applies to transactions that involve a business, governmental unit, or commercial situation. Auctions also lead to contracts, their sales of goods. An auction is an invitation to the audience to make an offer. So when you have the auctioneer up there and they're calling out prices, if you're a bidder and you bid, you've made an offer. You have not accepted a contract. You've made an offer. And the auction can be with reserve or without reserve. If it's made with reserve, then the auctioneer does not have to sell the items. They can withdraw the items if they don't sell for high enough. But an auction without reserve, the article or property or whatever cannot be withdrawn unless there are no bids. And a bidder always has the right to retract their bid until the auctioneer announces completion of the sale. Next, we're going to talk about title to assets, passage of title, and risk of loss. So title is the right to ownership of goods. Just because I hold something in my hand doesn't mean I hold title to something. If I steal it, I don't actually have title. A bill of sale is a written statement that provides evidence of the transfer of personal property from one person to another, and buyers generally acquire the title the seller had to the property. So if the seller has good, valid title to the property, they can pass that to the buyer. If, however, the seller has stolen property and the seller sells stolen property to a buyer cannot take good title in that stolen property, even if the buyer knew nothing about the theft. So void title is no title at all. That's what you would hold if you stole something. You'd hold a void title, which means you don't actually have title. Voidable title is title that may be voided if the injured party elects to do so. So this happens when goods are obtained because of another's fraud, misrepresentation, mutual mistake, undue influence, or duress. And we've talked about all these concepts before, but say I bought a car and it was misrepresented to me how many miles were on the car. I would have voidable title. I could get out of this contract if I wanted to, but the seller couldn't get out of the contract if they wanted to. The one making the misrepresentation cannot void the sale unless I want to void the sale. Also, when goods are bought from a minor or person who is mentally impaired, we have voidable title. If I have goods entrusted to a merchant, so I have jewelry and I leave my jewelry with a merchant to clean and repair it. If that merchant sells my jewelry to an innocent third party, which that means a third party who has no knowledge that jewelry belongs to me, that third party receives valid title. So the third party can take valid title to that and I am out of luck. Now what I can do, I said I'm out of luck, but I'm not really because I can sue the merchant for money damages, but I can't sue the merchant for the return of my jewelry. Passage of title and risk of loss generally depends on who has title. Generally, who has title bears the risk of loss. So if the goods I'm buying blow up, whoever has to pay for those, that's going to depend on who has title. Goods must be identified before title can pass. And then once identified, the title is going to pass when the seller does what the seller is required to do. So there are two types of contracts, shipment contracts and destination contracts. Under shipment contracts, the seller is going to deliver goods to a carrier for delivery. So to FedEx or something. And those are generally FOB shipping point contracts. That's what we call them. In that case, when the seller only is required to deliver the goods to FedEx, title is going to pass when the goods are placed with the carrier. So title passes when I drop the stuff off at FedEx. And when I say it passes, that means title passes to the buyer, which means that the buyer bears the risk of loss. So if FedEx loses the package, the buyer has a claim against FedEx, but the buyer doesn't have a claim against the seller. Destination contracts are different. In destination contracts, the seller is required to deliver the goods to the buyer's destination, and title is going to pass when the seller delivers to the buyer's destination. So these are FOB destination contracts. If we have one of these, an FOB destination contract, and the seller drops the goods with FedEx and FedEx loses the goods, the seller has to replace the goods or make the buyer whole. If it's not specified in the contract, it's going to be treated as a shipment contract. And if no delivery is required, the buyer picks up the goods and title is going to pass to the buyer when the contract is made. Risk of loss, though, is going to pass either when the buyer receives the goods, if the seller is a merchant, or when the seller tenders goods, which means offers goods to the buyer, if the seller is not a merchant. So here it's going to depend on whether or not the seller is a merchant. Fungible goods are exempt from the requirement to identify them prior to title and risk of loss passage. That's when I buy things that it doesn't really matter which one is mine, like natural resources, oil and gas. If I buy a certain quantity, we don't have to split that off before risk of loss and title can pass. Documents of title is paper giving the person who possesses the document the right to receive the goods described in the document. And then the agreement of the parties can change all these rules. So the parties may agree to a different time to pass title and risk of loss than what is in the UCC. Title can also be revested in the seller. If the buyer refuses to accept the goods, the title is always going to revert to the seller. If the buyer doesn't accept the goods because they don't conform to the contract, then the risk of loss remains with the seller the whole time. But if the goods do conform to the contract and the buyer still breaches, the buyer can bear the risk of loss. In this next slide, we're going to cover sales, returns, and insurable interests. So these are two different rules that can apply to contracts if in the contract. So there can be a sale on approval or a sale or return. A sale on approval is going to allow a return even if goods primarily for a buyer's use conform to the contract. So in this type of situation, the seller didn't breach. The seller did exactly what it was supposed to do, but the contract still allows return of goods. And these are goods primarily for the buyer's use. This applies when I buy things from a department store that I do not like. I go and I buy clothes and I try them on and I saw them, I agreed to them, I took them home and I decide to return them. These are sale on approval. These remain the property of the seller until the buyer approves by oral or written contract or by action. So if I just keep them, then they're not sale on approval anymore. They're property of the buyer. The risk of loss remains with the seller until the buyer approves. The second category is sale or return, and that's a sale that allows goods primarily for resale to be returned even though they conform. So these are similar concepts, but the buyer of the goods is different. In sale on approval, the buyer of the goods is primarily going to use those goods for their own use. In a sale or return situation, the goods are primarily held for resale by the buyer. In that case, buyer takes title to the goods with the right to revest that title in the seller after a specified period of time or a reasonable time. The buyer must care for the goods in a reasonable manner, and they must be returned at the buyer's expense. And then finally, an insurable interest allows insurance of property. And a buyer can insure property once they have a contract on goods. They don't have to actually own them, have title, or risk of loss. They can already insure them. And the seller can still insure them. They retain an insurable interest as long as they have title to the goods.